want to thank the choir this morning. They did double duty. They sang at 8:45 and 11. It's 20-year anniversary of 9/11 this weekend. I'm like many of you have thought a great deal about it, and you may be wondering this morning as you show up this morning, why are we talking so much about joy? I hope it makes sense by the time we're done. I think about Todd Beamer and Let's Roll, friends and family that we lost, the unspeakable evil that we experience. But this morning I don't want to focus on 9/11. I want to focus on the 20th anniversary of 9/12. Now I want to think back to 9/12. Do you remember what that was like? There was no northern or southern. There was no eastern or western. There was no conservative or liberal. There was no red or blue. We were purple. I want to think about 9/12/2001. One of the memes that I have seen across social media has been talking about that day. Why can't it be like that? You remember the God Bless America being sung. One of the traditions of the Braves now is God Bless America sung on Sundays. It came from 9/11. That how we've been impacted and how we've been shaped ever since. It's not your imagination. We have become meaner, angrier. Ever since 9/11, we have been quick to anger. All of us, me included. It's part of what shaped us. Those of us who have raised children since then, whose kids were very small, know the education system, know the education world that they have been raised in and challenged and changed, and we've become bloodthirsty. And it shows. I want to think back to 9/12. I want to think back to 9/12 and think of that joy that was there. Not joy in what we've experienced, but the joy that we found in one another. I said it wasn't joy at 8:45, and as soon as I said it, I regretted it. That there was joy that we found in one another. It was struggling mightily. It was hard to understand and to comprehend because we were so grief-stricken, but we did find joy in one another. I'd like for us to find that again. The text that you heard Donna read from Philippians, Paul wrote that letter while sitting in jail. It was right around 61, 62 AD. 10 years after the church in Philippi had been founded by Paul and Silas and Timothy and a couple of others, Paul was writing to them saying, even though I'm in jail, I have joy. 16 times in 4 chapters, he used the word joy and rejoice. He was saying to them, he was proclaiming to them, he was declaring to them, nothing can take away my joy in Christ. In verse 10, it tells the reason for this. In verse 10, it tells the reason for the entire book, to help you determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be found blameless. What is best? Joy. Joy in Christ. In community together, in faithfulness to God. Joy. But it's been hard. It is hard. This video that I'm about to show you has been kind of ringing in my ears for a while. And you're going to recognize that it's from the Green Mile. Big John's about to be executed. Tell me if some of the words resonate with you.
I want it to be over and done with. I do. I'm tired. Tired of being on the road, lonely as a sparrow in the rain. I'm tired of never having me a buddy to be with, to tell me where we's going to, coming from, or why. mostly I'm tired of people being ugly to each other. I'm tired of all the pain I feel in here in the world every day. There's too much of it. It's like pieces of glass in my head all the time. Can you understand?
Yes, John, I think I can.
It's like there's pieces of glass in my head. It feels that way, doesn't it? The anger, the violence, the frustration, the anxiety that surrounds us, it feels like glass in our heads. It feels like glass in our hearts and in our souls. And so let me say to you, if we let this glass continue in our heads and minds and soul, eventually our heads and our minds and our souls become glass. Easily breakable, easily shaken, easily destroyed. And this glass that is torturing us takes over. Paul is writing from a prison. He is writing wrongly accused. He is writing wrongly arrested, preaching and proclaiming a man wrongly killed. And he does not write about the ugliness and the nastiness of the Roman Empire, because that doesn't matter. What matters is he has Jesus. What matters is that he has joy in Christ and in God, and nothing can take that away from him. Nothing can remove that from him. How long has it been since you have felt that joy, that hope, that peace? Choose joy. Give joy. It's important that as we read these words, that as we hear these words from Paul, that we take them in and remember how easy it is for us to lose our way, how easy it is for us to lose our focus, to lose one another. It hasn't just been hard for 18 months, it's been hard for 20 years. And coming to grips with who we are and what we are and an enemy that hates us. That hates us. All of us. And we've become bloodthirsty. We must have joy. We must have faith in Jesus and faith in Christ that proclaims and shouts to the world joy, hope, peace, joy. I've been watching this show. Jen and I have started watching this show that I'm about to tell you about. It's called Ted Lasso. I did not want to watch it. It makes no sense for me to like it. It is a show about soccer. Do you know how much I know about soccer? I'll probably be an Atlanta United season ticket holder by the end of this show. And I have come to love it. It's not called a field. It's called a pitch. I'm learning. See, I am learning that one of the phrases there is be curious, not judgmental. And I'm learning how much I do not know and how much there is to learn. And I'm learning to come and to accept my weaknesses. If you've ever noticed me reading, sometimes it gets slow because I'm blind. And so over the last 2 weeks, I've had to come to accept that I need glasses. See, some of y'all are smiling because you're going, it's about time, big boy. We've known for a while. And some of you have been wearing glasses since you were a little kid. You have no sympathy for me right now. Some of you are just glasses, Derek. No big deal. But owning that 2010 vision that you once had is no longer there. Can we own in our own hearts that we feel violence? That we should be curious, not judgmental? Can we own the need that we have to experience the grace and the love of God more powerfully, more profoundly, that there are places and times that we come short, that we fall short? Can we own that? This episode that you're about to watch, this scene that you're about to watch from Ted Lasso, now I am not approving of the language, okay? So let's get that out of the way. There's no language in this video. I have watched it 53 times to make sure there's no language in the video. But the team mascot is a dog that gets killed by a soccer ball that one of the players kicks. And the team is struggling and having a hard time, and the media is meeting with Coach Ted Lasso. And well, they ask him this question.
And how many more matches do you think can end in a draw before you hit the panic button?
Well, Marcus, there's two buttons I never like to hit, all right? And that's panic and snooze. Who else? What about this fellow right here?
Trent Krim. I was wondering if you had any comments on Earl, the dog Danny Rojas killed today.
Trent Krim, bringing that heat. Yeah. Well, when I was 3 years old, I got attacked by our neighbor's dog. I don't remember it happening, but my mother said it was pretty scary, you know. I do remember being afraid of dogs while growing up, though. Like, if I was at a friend's house for a sleepover or something, they'd have to keep their family dog outside, otherwise I'd bawl my eyes out. Then in high school, our neighbor, Mr. Grady, well, his wife passed away. And he was real sad about that, as you can imagine. And he just kind of stopped taking care of their dog. Same one that bit me. His name was Hank. And so I started looking after him, you know, feeding him, taking him on walks, playing fetch, all that fun stuff. Eventually, Mr. Grady's son moved his dad into a nursing home, and he asked if I wanted to keep Hank, and I was like, yeah, heck yeah. And then a year or so after that, we had to put Hank to sleep. It's funny to think about the things in your life that can make you cry, just knowing that they existed, can then become the same thing that make you cry knowing that they're now gone. I think those things come into our lives to help us get from one place to a better one. And I hope we helped Earl do just that. We're gonna miss him around here a whole bunch.
And how's Danny doing?
I haven't spoken with him yet, but I just hope he's not being too hard on himself, you know?
The things that make us cry because they existed can make us cry because they no longer exist. That is the story that Paul is telling from a Roman jail. He used to be the attack dog, chasing and persecuting and attacking Christians, trying to kill them, ready to destroy anything that was not part of his faith. Does that sound familiar? Now standing from a jail and saying, the one thing that I used to hate now gives me hope, now gives me joy. Let me share it with you. It was right about a year ago that Marla called me and said, I need to meet with you. She said, Derek, it's time for me to retire. How do you have joy for someone who gets to go play with grandkids and gets to go be with Justin and Chelsea and Jesse and is going to get to do all that and have the joy for him, but at the same time go, no. Because you can have joy and it still be tough. And so we began to have the conversation in January when she retired of how do we... You don't fill Marla's shoes. You don't replace Marla. You follow Marla. We have a 10 o'clock rule here where you can't work after 10 o'clock at night here. Do you know why? Because Marla would work till midnight. 75, 80 hours a week. It was just who she was. How do you follow that? And so we began to have meetings and conversations of this person's going to have an unbelievable work ethic. They're going to have to love people. They're going to have to give of themselves. They're going to have to literally give pieces and parts of themselves to be able to follow Marla. Tiffany McClure, everybody.
Good morning. So what does it look like to love the person in front of us? It's going to be different for every one of us. For me this year, it was a 14-year-old girl I'd never met. It culminated in January of this year, 8 months ago, but it actually began when I lived in Hawaii over 2 decades ago. See, I signed up on the registry to be a bone marrow donor and promptly forgot about it. 3 years and 3 moves later, I got a frantic call from the National Bone Marrow Registry. They'd been trying to find me for months. They'd been trying to find me through 3 moves, 3 houses in 3 states. I was a military spouse at the time. It was pre-Google, and we moved a lot. See, I was the only match for a child in Seattle with leukemia. She was 10. They finally tracked me down through my paternal grandmother, and she was a bit suspicious, but they convinced her they were legitimate, and she gave them my phone number. Grandma was suspicious of everyone, now that I think about it. She still gave them my number. My blood was taken, and in 24 hours, it was sent to a national lab. A match was confirmed, and arrangements were made to fly me down there within the next 2 weeks to donate. That child died before I could make it. I swore then and there that not only would my information always be updated, but if I ever had another chance to help another child with something I could absolutely live without, I 1,000,000% would. Because this story has haunted me for 20 years. What if I'd updated my information? What if they'd been able to find me sooner? What if I'd kept in contact? What if? What if? Who knows? Who knows? Well, God knows. And God knows more than anything else what it means to love the person in front of us, even in the middle of a pandemic. In June of 2020, I learned a friend's niece, who I had never met before, was going through kidney failure at the age of 14, same age as my daughter. I also knew from previous tests and donations that my blood type was that of universal donor. So I raised my hand. I didn't raise it lightly and not think it through. I didn't raise my hand and say, hey, you can have my left kidney, and can we have Chick-fil-A for dinner tonight? No, I researched the heck out of it. The pros and the cons, I saw what other donors had experienced, and I read about what I could expect, what life changes would have to happen. I found other people who had donated, and I spoke to them, and then I took a deep breath, and I reached out. Nothing happened immediately. I spent the next 6 months undergoing tests, counseling, interviews, talking to a patient advocate, speaking with physicians and surgeons and nutritionists, and underwent x-rays and EKGs and CT scans. And let me tell you, I gave away more bodily fluids than any of y'all want to know about. But finally, on January 4th of this year, 8 months ago, I went to the Peoria Transplant Center in Peoria, Illinois, and I had my left kidney evicted and relocated. See, organ donation, it's not about us. It's about the lives we help that we may never know about. It's about the mothers and fathers and siblings and grandparents of friends of someone we may never meet who will have their world and their laughter and their joy given back to them. It's about love. It's about sharing love with the person in front of us. It's about choosing joy and sharing joy and giving joy back. And it's a gift freely given that enables any one of us to change the world. Now, I was in discomfort for a few weeks. I did a lot of sleeping. That part was pretty awesome, to be honest. I had to take it easy, and I was blessed to have a mother who flew down from Alaska to spend time with her grandchildren. I mean, to help take care of me. I had a husband who supported me every single step of the way. I had books to read, a dog who was thrilled to snore beside me. We ordered a lot of takeout. And you know what? It was okay. I came into this world with two kidneys. I'll leave with one. And with the knowledge that the other one made a difference outside of my body. Now, I had the opportunity to meet my donor for the very first time the evening before the surgery. 14-year-old Kara and I met, and we shared giggles and stories, and then 12 hours later, we shared an organ. Now, Kara and the kidney that was formerly known as mine, they're doing fantastic. They've both taken to each other with a lot of enthusiasm, and honestly, I think my kidney likes her more than it ever liked me. And every time I see an update from her on social media or her mom texts me to check in and tell me stories of Kara's adventures, of things she wasn't even able to do just 2 years ago, I know it was all worth it. So last Monday, Kara and I both had our six-month follow-up checkup. Technically, it's been 8 months, but in hospital math, that's 6 months. And last week, Kara's mom let me know Kara got the all clear from her surgeon to once again play softball for the first time in 3 years and to ride a roller coaster. My current goal right now is to figure out how we can meet up and ride a roller coaster together so I can have both of my kidneys on the roller coaster, just, you know, in two separate people. Talk about sharing joy and possibly also some screams. So any one of us can change the world when we love the person in front of us, beside us, behind us. And any one of us today can wake up and choose joy and give joy. You don't have to donate a kidney, but if you want more information about that, see me afterwards. There's a million ways out there to go forth, share joy, and love the person in front of you. So go, because the life you change, it will be your own. Amen.
Think back to January 2021. How hard it was, how angry it was. This was happening. God was at work. Well, and we wanted to love Tiffany in front of us, and so we, without her knowing, did this.
Good morning, all. My name is Jennifer. This is Kara. We had the privilege of meeting Tiffany when she donated one of her kidneys to Kara. We had a scare last June, didn't even know anything was going on with Kara, and found out that both of her kidneys failed and she needed a transplant. We did not know Tiffany at all. She knew my sister, and through these stories that we put out there on Kara's story, Tiffany, she was going to donate one of her kidneys to Kara. So she didn't know us. She didn't know Kara at all. She met my sister, I believe, through school. So luckily for us, my sister knew her and she saw the story. So through her and her family, all of are amazing. Her family's amazing. She's amazing. They all came together and made it happen so Tiffany could donate her kidney to Kara. We met Tiffany the night before before the transplant, and her husband, and they were nice, funny, sweet, just amazing, just an amazing couple.
I'm grateful that she was able to donate a kidney, because I wouldn't have known how long I would have went through the process, like having to start dialysis or having to keep being in and out of the hospital because I couldn't have gotten a kidney. So I'm grateful that she was able to actually donate one.
Yes. We are too. And then the night we met her, she's like, we're moving at the end of the month. And I'm like, you're donating a kidney and then moving all of a sudden. Now that's a lot. Yeah. But we are so thankful for her. Thank you so much, Tiffany. Thank you for your your selfless act, your everything. You're an amazing person, and I will always be grateful for you for helping my daughter out. So thank you very much.
We choose joy. We choose to give joy, and we choose joy. No matter what happens, we choose joy. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand and sing.